Today I'm in Buckley and I'm talking with DennisThomas, and you've got some stories that you've told to various little groups around Deeside. Is there any one in particular that you've unexpectedly had a response from your audience, would you say?
I think the greatest one, there were two actually. One, when I went as a guinea pig down to Porton Down and was experimented on with nerve gas, that was one. And the other one that stands out in my mind, of course, was the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Well, tell me about Porton Down, and we've heard lots of reports about servicemen who were used as guinea pigs.
A lot of ex-servicemen say that they were told it was experiments for the common cold. In my case, that wasn't so. I will remember, on orders, it said volunteers are required to go for physiological experiments. I imagine, of course, that would be a bit of PT, possibly a 5 mile run and things like that. At that age, the word physiological didn't really mean a lot to me. It offered you an extra pound a week, which at that time almost doubled my salary, and an extra 3 days off. Sealand wasn't a particularly happy camp. I didn't like the place. It was almost like being back on square bashing, and it was a chance to get away from Sealand for a week. So, pound a week extra, 3 extra days off, and get away from RAF Sealand for a few days. And that's the reason I volunteered.
And what was actually asked of you? What did you have to do?
Well, what they did is they took us down, I went down there, and we were put in a normal barrack room. And then on the day, Saturday it was when I arrived. On the Monday, I think there was 8 of us put in the gas chamber. You had a gas mask, didn't have a gas mask on, but you had a bag on your back and that had a tube that went round into your mouth. So you breathed in through your nose, and you breathed out, and then they measured the bag afterwards, obviously. I don't know quite how they did it or anything, but anyway, we were in the gas chamber for about a minute and a half. And the bell went when they released the nerve gas. And within, I would think, 30 seconds, my vision blurred, breathing was heavy, and a few seconds after that, went completely blind, and the breathing was just terrible. And after a minute and a half, they let us out. I collapsed on the grass outside, and sometime after me, a man called Ron Madison actually died in the gas chamber. And the thing that always sticks in my mind, we were then taken back to the barrack room, put on our beds, couldn't see anything, breathing was terrible. And at no time did an MO or a doctor or anybody come in to see how we were, to check on us or see if they could ease things or never. And then after a couple of days, we were taken back up to their laboratory and they had a big window. And the vision by then was beginning to clear a little. And we were asked to judge distances. And they didn't seem to be concerned about anything very much, actually, as regarded our general health. I never remember being checked or anybody putting a stethoscope on my chest or anything like that, you know. And I'm not too sure whether that had any long-term effects on me. It apparently has on lots of people. And when Ron Madison, I was then discharged at the end of the week and I came home in a hell of a state. I would probably say the journey from Salisbury back to North Wales on what were crowded trains in those days is probably one of the worst journeys I've ever made. It was a really awful journey. A lot of it was spent standing up as well because trains were overcrowded in those days. I couldn't call my local doctor because I was sworn to secrecy. So I couldn't tell the doctor what had caused my problem, so that had to be left. The 3 days off, of course, that gave me the 3 extra days, was spent just recovering. And then even when I got back to the unit, improving every day, but I couldn't go to the MO and even tell him what had happened to me. Ron Madison died sometime after that in the gas chamber. And his inquest was held in camera, totally secret. His parents didn't know why he died. And it wasn't until some 8 to 10 years ago that his sister raised the issue. She wanted to know why her brother had died. And the result of what that was, that the Wiltshire police got involved, and there was a huge case over it, you may recall it in the papers. And after some 8 years, the government said, well, we're going to make you this offer of £8,000 each, and you can settle for that, or you don't get anything. So by that time, about 1,000 odd of us had got together. And after all the hassle, I've got a file up there, which is yay thick, of all the letters I received over that period of time. And we finally settled for £8,000 each. Some men may require more than that, I don't know. Odd things have happened to me over the years, and whether that's been caused by the nerve gas, I have no idea.
But let's just for a moment, I'm trying to think now, as a young man, susceptible to ideas from superiors, did you feel afterwards, after you'd been taken ill, some resentment towards the authority?
No, I can't say that I did. No. It's one of those things, you just take it in your stride, you know.
Did you feel that you were making a contribution to scientific research?
Well, yes, yeah. It didn't affect me greatly, you know, but I was hoping I was making some contribution.
And when one of your comrades sadly passed away, did you feel that that was almost inevitable and a worthy sacrifice?
Well, of course, I didn't know that Ron had died. I didn't know what had happened until his sister raised the issue all those years after.
Yes. How did you feel afterwards when more and more of these sad stories, these unfortunate endings came out? How did you feel then? Did you feel in any way that you'd been duped or exploited?
No, I think most people, there's big issues made. It's the same with these lads in Afghanistan, you know, and I think they have the same outlook, actually. They volunteer, they go in the army or any one of the forces, actually. If something happens to them, then really you've brought it on yourself by volunteering. And I don't think I don't have a big issue with it at all, you know. The forces did all right by me, actually. And I think on the whole, apart from that issue at Porton Down, otherwise I was well looked after. The second thing, of course, the big thing, and it was the Cuban Missile Crisis.